The last lecture of the day in memory of S.A. Dangi, a founding member of the Communist Party of India and a stalwart of Indian trade union movement. Dangi was arrested by the British authorities for communist and trade union activities and was jailed for an overall period of 13 years. He joined the All India Communist Party and later the United Communist Party of India. He was also the founder of the Socialist, the first socialist weekly in India. This lecture is titled Marx 21, the reactualization of the philosophical heritage, and will be delivered by Professor Mikhail Pavlov. This lecture will be chaired by Craig Brandist, Professor, University of Sheffield, UK. Can I request our speaker as well as our chair to please come on stage? Craig Brandist is a professor of cultural theory and intellectual history and the director of the Bakhtin Center at the University of Sheffield, UK. He has published extensively on the work of the Bakhtin Circle, Antonio Gramsci's relationship to Russian Marxist thought, and the development of sociological linguistics in the USSR. He's currently working with Peter Thomas on a collection of archival documents and commentary on Gramsci's time in the USSR in the early 1920s, and also on the development of early Soviet Oriental studies, its Stalinist distortion and heritage in the post-colonial theory today. Can I now request our chair to please take over the proceedings?
Okay, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Mikhail Pavlov from the Lomonosov Moscow State University from the Department of Political Economy, where he's the editor of the of Questions of Political Economy. He holds a position of associate professor in the department, and he's very proud of the fact that I understand his father was an Indologist, and Mikhail carries on the interest in India from his father. But today, Mikhail's going to speak on Marx 21, a reactualization of the philosophical heritage.
Yes, thank you. First of all, I want to thank Adria University and all organizers of this high level in all the senses, especially intellectual and interesting conference. I have gifts with me, books and journals, but a little later. My father was a famous Indologist, specialist in Indian religions and social philosophy. He was philosopher, I'm an economist. My father was advisor to Indira Gandhi on Indian-Soviet relations. He was chairperson of Department of World Political Process in Faculty of Philosophy, the same Lomonosov Moscow State University, as I am. Organizers of this conference in Andrei University are really great thinkers and visionaries. My father knew very well this famous Indian communist, Shripad Amrit Dange, and whom this memorial lecture is devoted. And I am really happy to receive this invitation to India, because from the moment I was born, I was in the atmosphere of Indian culture. My father visited India more than 30 times, have many friends, and talk about India frequently. We, father and me, have very little opportunities to visit India after the disintegration, catastrophic disintegration of the Soviet Union. So it's great opportunity for me given by Adri. Thank you so much. Let me deliver this lecture that we prepared with Alexander Buzgalin, professor at Lomonosov Moscow State University, the same department as me, political economy department, my teacher. And both me and Professor Buzgalin represent post-Soviet school of critical Marxism. Alexander Buzgalin is a leader of this school, the leader. There are many debates within the post-Soviet school of critical Marxism. It is a network that includes many well-known Russian scholars who over the past 25 years produced more than 50 books and hundreds of articles. I have some books with me. There are some common points and achievements of this school in modern economy analysis. Post-Soviet school of critical Marxism, and you know what is why it is called critical Marxism, post-Soviet, that there were greatly changes in Marxism studies, Marxism movement, and there in Soviet time we have dogmatic Marxism, but now it is critical Marxism. And this school study questions that concern every citizen of the modern world, questions of the structure and contradiction of modern market, of the causes and consequences of the dominance of finance capital, of the mechanisms and outcomes of the subordination of humanity and labor to corporate capital, of the contradictions between first and third worlds, and so forth. Most of schools studying the nature of commodities, money, and capital study this phenomena from the standpoint of neoclassical economic theory and of neo-institutionalism. But modern global economy is encountering fundamental problems that mainstream economic thought is finding insoluble. And only Marxism could give answers to these questions. Nevertheless, very few integrated conceptual works provided answers to the question of how the economy has changed since the time of Das Kapital have appeared during this period. Following the crisis, global economic crisis of 2007-2009, and understandable interest in Marxism arose, and this has not died away. Theory and methodology of Marxism reactualized on modern basis can provide answers to the core questions of economic practice in the early part of the 21st century, questions on which neoclassical school has generally remained silent. Why, for instance, has the modern market become total? George Soros' term, totalitarian market, is character because market subordinates all spheres of human life, try to do so. What lies behind the transformation of money from universal equivalent to a virtual product of financial capital, and why this capital achieved renewed dominance? And how corporate capital subordinate to itself not only labor of human beings, but also human beings themselves in their individual qualities? And are crises still inevitable accompaniment of the market economy? You know that dominance of manual reproduction was changed by industrial reproductive labor, its historical approach, and now there is a shift toward creative activity. Creative activity is contradictory unit of universal and individual labor. At the same time, it is activity, dialogue, and relation at the same time. not only work, not only activity. It's very complicated phenomena. And there is evolution of personality from patriarchal type of human in history toward Homo or economicus, and now it is Homo creator. And Homo creator has new system of values and motivation. First, activity or work activity is a broader term, more adequate term, is a value. Motivator is work itself, not salary, not some other material benefits, but process of work. Second, diffusion of the border between labor and free time. In Marx's time, there was certain border, certain border between labor and free time, but now we see the solution of this border. Free time is a value, and motivation through increasing of free time. As you know, Google Corporation give every person, every worker of this corporation the whole day, Friday, to work on its own project, not for fulfilling the tasks that set by managers. And this is the third self-realization in dialogue with other people and dialogue with nature. And you know about new challenge, fourth industrial revolution, that Klaus Schwab, leader of Davos Economic Forum, promotes automatization, robotization, artificial intellect, and dramatically increasing unemployment as a consequence of production process free of human labor force. And new concepts like basic income and so free time are arising. But we see not only technological optimism. Market has become not only global, but totalitarian force that is no longer a socially neutral mechanism of coordination. It is now a product of hegemony of corporate capital, featuring the intensive and extensive growth of new types of commodity. Information, simulacra, you know, term simulacra, and so forth. We observe new qualities acquired by value, use value, price and commodity fetishism within this new market. Live exploring contradictions of new non-limited resources, such as knowledge, and the commodity form, pervert mutant form of their existence. And capital becomes a result of complex system of exploitation. In the 21st century, context of this exploitation includes classic extraction of surplus value from industrial workers combined with internal corporate redistribution of income by insiders. International exploitation on the international level, and the exploitation of creative labor through process of expropriation of intellectual rent. Further, modern capital imposes its hegemony not only on labor, but also on free time, and greatly affect not only the labor power of human individual, but personality and mode of thinking, and so on. So, there are questions that modern Marxism face. How modern Marxism answers the challenges of new epoch? Do today Marxists have theoretical explanations for such new phenomena as the commodification of knowledge and information, financialization, social and human capital, market fundamentalism, and so forth. And whether modern Marxism possesses something resembling the capital of the 21st century. This question has attracted particularly keen interest since the outbreak of global economic crisis. And we discussed this book for almost today on our conference. And we consider that market-centric model of economic theory must remain in the past. We are trying to show that when renewed in a critical spirit, classic works of political economy are able to provide meaningful answers to the challenges of a new epoch. In particular, we contend that market-centric economic theory has never provided an adequate description of the economic system of capitalism, despite rejecting certain principles related to the functioning of its superficial forms. Under conditions of late capitalism, the potential of this economic theory as a tool for fruitful research has narrowed still further. But we show that a renewed variant of classical political economy can explain the causes of the crisis, the nature of money and capital, and the place and role of the human individual in the economic life of the 21st century. And you know, not even 2 years after the demise of Soviet Union, the guru of postmodernism, Jacques Derrida, delivered a sensational lecture of the non-disappearance, relevance, presence of the specter of Marx as a reality. That was only beginning. Disappointment with narrow pragmatic positivist studies and with all deconstructing postmodernism has grown both among scholars and among thoughtful people in general. More and more perceptibly, the preconditions are accumulating and the search for alternatives is beginning to grow. And we see that there is thesis of a new linear historical dynamic. This concept is one of the principal methodological arguments that shows why the recoil of post-market trends that has characterized the end of the 20th and the beginning of the 21st century does not spell the downfall of this theoretical development. The reverse movement of social time is one of the possible vectors for the birth of the new. This is the territory into which we are setting out or set out some time ago, but the reverses that have accompanied our first steps do not mean the path we have chosen, socialism, movement to communism, is incorrect. And we see that socio-economic type of personality, values and motives of individual will differ qualitatively in different economic systems and for people who personify different production relations within a particular system. If it is system based on personal dependency, the owner will strive to maximize not his or her profits, but the number of his or her slaves or serfs, and get as much land as he could. Within the framework of the commodity capitalism system, within capital, the owner of commodity is interested above all in possessing a certain use value. An extreme case here would be that of a shopaholic. The owner of money is interested in savings. Here we may cite the example of the wealthy miser. While the owner of capital is interested in risky activity that maximizes profit. Hired workers, meanwhile, are interested in the maximizing of wages, in social reform, and in revolutions. We developed this classical position of Marx in accordance with new methodological parameters. We put emphasis on the study of non-linear, multi-scenario, socio-economic transformation of the modern epoch. For political economy, this means taking up the challenge of studying the process of the non-linear genesis and decline of economic systems, of transitional production relations, and especially significant under these conditions of retroactive determinations. And we describe new content of commodities, of money and capital that is characteristic of these categories under conditions where the global hegemony of capital is taken on a socio-economic form typical of the decline of capitalism. Just as the rise of the capitalist system transforms the content of the categories of commodity, money, and capital, so the decline of the capitalist system, which Marx was not able to study, is also transforming the content of these categories, with the starting point of this process lying in transitional forms. We observe market centricity of modern economic theory, as I told before, and the problems involved in overcoming it. Especially in neoclassical economic theory, but partly in Marxist economic theory as well, the market and value are widely viewed as extra-historical phenomena, making up a sort of universal mechanism for the efficient allocation of resources. In the framework of neoclassicism, the market is seen as socially neutral and asserting the nature of quality of human beings as egoists. Analytical Marxism and many currents close to it regard the market as a kind of abstraction of a system of relations in which objective and automatic accounting of expenditures is performed and an optimal distribution of resources among areas of activity take place. Consequently, most theoretical economists in their everyday work reduce the economy as a whole to the market. This goes unnoticed and at the same time is not questioned. But theoretical school that argues that the market is not the sole possible mode of existence of the economy is dangerous, above all for the reason that whatever the intentions of the founder, it opens the way for posing questions concerning the historical nature of market economy as a system that arose at a certain point and that, like all historical systems, is destined at a certain point to be transformed into a different economic system. So it is real dangerous for market system and for market realm. And we see that not only the development of post-market economic relations, but also qualitative changes in the basis of material production. The transition, as Marx put it, to a society located on the other side of the ladder place substantial limits on the development of commodity relations. The situation negates the very foundations of the development of the market, whether in the spirit of conventional economics or within the framework of the Marxist paradigm, production by solitary producers under the conditions of the social division of labor. In any case, we are concerned with the development of a new quality of social activity. This quality consists in growth in the share and role of creative activity, lying on the other side of material production and using and creating unlimited resources, knowledge, and other cultural phenomena that can only be de-objectified. You know the word objecting and de-objecting. It can be de-objectified in a process of a kind of dialogue when creator nowadays is trying to understand what creator in the past thought about the subject of his creative efforts and which decisions and why he made. The objectivation, the objecting is a reverse process when you have thoughts, you have ideas, and you implement these ideas in material form. And this is the reverse process, the objectivation, the objecting when you look on material implementation and why this smartphone was made in that way, not the other. Why it could be smaller, it could have a round shape or so on. What was the thoughts of its creator? And it is a very interesting process because it's a dialogue in time between past, present, between generations, between cultures, and so on. It's real integration and real growth of thought, of knowledge in the world. And this is the new world of creative activity in which pie of goods, for example, pie, subject to consumption. Here, one might say, assimilation is innate. Moreover, the nature of this pie, the world of culture or creator sphere, is such that it grows and develops to the extent that it is eaten. When you get only material pie, you eat it, you consume it, and it became less. And the lesser became smaller. And when you have pie of knowledge, and when you eat this pie, not consume, it is not suitable word, it became bigger and bigger. It grows. And when you have one idea and me have one idea and we exchange these ideas, we have not only one idea, but we have two ideas. not for material production, where we have you have one apple and I have one orange, and we exchange and we have only one apple and one orange. So that is more interesting world. The more eaters and the more eagerly they eat, the more pies there are. Such is the fundamental law of this world. It is similar to network effects. The more complex the network, the higher its value for participants consisting this network. The reason, I repeat, is simple. Creative activity is not the consumption of limited material resources, but it is the objectifying of cultural phenomena, for example, knowledge. If Einstein eats the pie of knowledge baked by Newton, the sum quantity of knowledge increases. The pie has grown bigger. This is merely a simplified illustration of the qualitative changes that occur during the development of creative activity lying on the other side of material production. Of fundamental importance is the fact that the dominant relations in the area of the creator sphere are not those of reallocation, which characterizes commodity relations and involve conceiving of human relations as relations between things or between commodities, but of the objectification of human creativity in the phenomena of culture. Market economy presupposes an exchange of equivalence with mutual alienation being a consequence of the labor process. The development of collective creativity brings to light a strange phenomenon in which the process of collaborating and exchanging activity can see one receiving the product of labor of one's counter agent without in the process losing one's own product, without alienation. The exchange of such goods or even of information products leads to a situation in which one multiplies the result while entering into a dialogue with one counter agent or with the value that one has created. Concurrently, one is not consuming. A person can continue either with the material bearer or with the value itself. And the world of collective creativity, creator sphere, is characterized by connection of new type. The greater the number of users interested in de-objectifying the cultural phenomenon you have created, the lower the specific cost that each user has to meet for its creation. It's a system of distribution of cost. And the contrast between the value assessment of the market world and the world of cultural values is obvious. In the market world, an increase in demand for a product that results is an increase in its price. In the world of cultural values, an increase in the value of a product leads to the cost price to the user falling, ultimately approaching zero. And there are some new phenomena and thesis that Marxism formulated more than 150 years ago is now embodied visibly in such phenomena as copyleft, crowdsourcing, Wikinomics, and open source. And the aim of presented analysis was to show that market-centric model of economic theory cannot provide the answers to fundamental questions of modern economy. The reduction of all non-market phenomena to flavors of the market creates obstacles to the theoretical analysis, and using proper forms, practically the most perspective mechanisms of economic progress, post-market relations as adequate form of the progress of mass creativity, progress of productive forces and human being simultaneously. And we must revisit and revise Marx's philosophical heritage. And because there are new forms of economy are emerging, me and Alexander Busgalin want to propel this process and not only reverse, but straightforward movement and prepared shifts exact that were examined in this lecture. Knowledge shifts. Thank you very much. Thank you, Adria University, and organizers of such wonderful conference. And I have books and journals.
Would you like to stay for questions? Okay, we've got 5 minutes for questions, please. So I suggest we take perhaps three and then see how we are for time. So who'd like to indicate, who'd like to speak?
Please. Yeah, so my question is about you know, when you talk about knowledge formation in the contemporary period, so I was wondering, you know, how do you see the role of imperialism, like contemporary imperialism, vis-a-vis the question of knowledge? And specifically, you know, I ask this because in many sort of circles in the West, the persistence of imperialism itself is a debated concept, right? So for, say, for instance, thinkers like Hart and Negri, imperialism already is supposed to be a thing of the past, right? And Lenin's ideas are also supposed to be a thing of the past. So when you talk about post-Soviet critical Marxism, you know, does that dispense with Lenin in a similar way to Hart and Negri, or is there something else going on? Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll ask three questions.
Okay, let's.
Okay, any more questions?
You said that market has not only become global but also totalitarian. In fact, most of the rightist scholars have been branding USSR as totalitarian state, in the sense that it was closed, absolute state power, centralized power, etc. But in what sense you are saying that market has become totalitarian, in the same sense or different sense?
I think we had some difficulty hearing all of that. Could you say it again?
You said that market has become global and totalitarian.
Yes.
Whereas the rightist scholars have been branding USSR as totalitarian state, in the sense that it had centralized power, it was undemocratic, it was closed. But in what sense you are using the term totalitarian for market?
Okay, thank you. Next question. No? Okay.
Well, thank you. It's very interesting questions. And about imperialism. And imperialism and globalization. are very similar process. And you know that in Soviet time, we consider imperialism as not only higher stage, but we have scholars that consider imperialism as a start of decline, not only market system, but also human culture as a whole. So we saw the reverse movement, and it is very complicated, contradictory process. And you know the phenomena of economic imperialism, when economic theory explains all the motives, stimulus, and aims for economic activity. And imperialism is very strong, but now we see the dominance of non-market coordination. It is coordination by large corporations, non-market activity at all. And there are many civil organizations and many networks that neglect those rules that were described by Alfred Marshall or some more theorists from economics wing of thoughts from mainstream. And there is the necessity to create such theory. It's only example of transformation as a cultural value or creative activity. Thank you. And the other questions is about totalitarian market, and it became global and totalitarian. When you see that we want to use different colors for our books, but there is phenomena of private property, of patent property, patent relations, when Pepsi Cola corporations patented blue color as their corporate style. And you know what business and businessman, it's a kind of activity, it's kind of all-consuming activity. Because reproduction of capital and capital itself requires constant movement, and it sets to action all the process and involves humans not to be just all rounded humans with all kind of qualities, but homo economicus with very narrow qualities, with abilities to get money from everything and everywhere. And This is a phenomenon of totalitarian market when you could not help to your relatives because you have business meeting, because you are hired worker, and your boss could not let you go out and help those who need your help. And when we see process of financialization and homo finances, who determine all his life only by language, by terms of money, not the other. When the exchange rate is more important than the weather forecast or how his friends doing. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Have I think answered? We're out of time. So thank you, Mikhail, for an interesting paper.
Thank you, Professor Pavlov and Professor Brandis. Can I request Dr. Sunita Lal to present the memento to our speaker?
Sure.
We're now going to have a 15-minute tea break. Can I request everyone to be back in the room in 15 minutes?